This area here is going to be really dark afterwards. As you can probably guess. Pull in some of this light over here. You can see what I've done there. Spread some of that in the wrong places. Very easily done. There we go. Now here we're going to put in a few bits of darks just to try and bring out these bits of hair. I mind using a bit of brown down in this area. Maybe some trying to mix the direction up a bit here. In a few spots. Hope you can see what I'm doing here. Just very finely adding some hairs in. Or indicators of hairs, as the case might be. And again, shortly we'll re-blend these in. somehow. I'm just using the white on top of this at the moment. Which isn't always ideal. I can come back and play this area later on without any major catastrophes, but I can get this area mapped in. Probably got a bit of a toe under this part here, I think. So I might want to just draw that in. I'm going to want. Probably a bit of a pinky brown. This is a 188. So I'm just going to put in a bit of a shade here. Just to indicate a bit of a toe in there. That's actually a bit too brown. Blend this back in later. I've got a same over here, quite a large pad of a toe. So I'm going to draw that in there a little bit, and it'll largely be hidden by the time this is all done. Those myriad of hairs and other bits that come along and down and around and everything else you can think of around here. Right, I quite like that. I don't want the same colours on here particularly, which is something to be mindful of. We might just want to bring in a little bit of brown. Come back to these edges now and try and get them to work in well. Just adding some very subtle hints. down here, not so important because we're going to be drawing with the white an awful lot here. In fact, there's also, what colour would we call that there? Probably going back to that nice pink we had before. So, around here, we have this sort of pink colour, and that's coming out. Remember what I said about not trying to draw too many individual hairs? Doesn't work. But nevertheless, giving the hint of hairs can be quite good. I'm not trying to worry too much about blending the white here, just getting the, this is like a base for the whiskers. Little hairs around the side of the little creature's mouth, and this pink, there's quite a few bits of it up here. Just around this area. I'll do a few in random directions just to break it up a bit. There we go. You can probably find there's some bit of pink down here as well. It might be a brighter pink actually. Just looking at that there. And there'll certainly be some greys. Certainly where we want to blend this into the white afterwards. We want it to be a very gradual transition. And you need something to bring the white out as well. So we know there's a brown spot here, but it's not really brown in reality. But it has to be an indicator of it. Quite grey down there, so I'm not going to concentrate too much on adding loads of whites. So now I've got a fairly sharp pencil. We could probably do it being a little bit sharper for this part. So back to my little trick. I'm just rubbing it on here like this. It's just bringing me a bit of a sharper edge, and that way I can use some more of the lead without having to worry too much about sharpening every 5 seconds. And here I'm just going to concentrate on pulling some hairs up. Just pausing every now and again just to make sure from the reference that we are going in the right direction. The whisker coming across here. Don't worry too much about getting this bright white yet, because it's not going to stay bright white, never does. Not on these edges. And the white here sort of blends with the pinks that we just put on a few minutes ago. So the pinks stretch out a little bit further than the white. And the white then is the uppermost layer down here. Again, we're pretty much working like a blind man. The reference photo doesn't tell us what we need to know as to where the colours are going here. And that's okay. I lost the sharpness of this a little bit, so let's bring it back again. And as we start to build up the white layers here, this white becomes more and more obvious. Work your pencil both ways, don't just go one direction, you know, do it both ways. Hairs are a little bit random, so it's not a problem. And this area here has got a few white streaks in. Here you've got to use a bit of sense of what you're doing. So you know that from the base of the nose here, these hairs are going to go in this direction. And then they're going to curve quite rapidly. Here. So they're going over there. This gives you a good idea of how I'm layering the fur. I might want to think about drawing that nose in fairly soon. And so I will possibly make that another tutorial, because the nose has some quite strong detail. You can't see it on here, but I've drawn a few of these dogs, so I know roughly what we need to do there. So I'll show you a few techniques. I've done it in graphite rather than pastel, so it could prove interesting. Can we transfer the graphite technique that I use on those to the pastel? I don't know, but we will soon find out. See how that area there, we didn't need to put too much detail in because these hairs here do make a difference. At some point, I may need to get a different pastel involved. I'm hoping to deal with that actually, because this is quite nicely, but the base layer of the paper is creating quite a nice mid-tone, especially on this sort of colour. So I'm not having to add some ridiculous levels of white. I can just put this very delicate base layer on, pretty much how we started already. We do want to make sure that the whole area does appear to be white, so that this doesn't just look like a shadow, it looks like a patch of hair. And again, without the reference working in our favour, some of it is guesswork. But it doesn't hurt to break it up a little bit in places. There's a spot just here like that. That's some sort of slightly finer white hairs. And then about there, is it about there? Yeah. That's when we start coming around like this. Always put the odd hair sticking out a bit further. And I always have the odd hair going in the wrong direction, because I think it adds to the realism of it. And before we added some pink here to add a bit more depth. And there's some quite visible hairlines here, so we need to look at that soon. On the reference photo, all this area here, it's just basically a solid white. So we're using artistic license. I love that word. It's something my old art teacher used to say an awful lot. And we're using memory, knowing that the fur radiates out in these directions, to really add these layers in. I'm going to need to sharpen this again, but it's working quite nicely at the moment, to add in some layering effects, like these edges here. It's those little bits that you see me struggle with there. The pencil's not making much difference now because there's a lot of pastel already in this area. And in fact, on the camera, it might look like it's meant to look. The lighting here is not amazing, despite using daylight bulbs and so on and so forth. And I think next, so we've got this side mapped in. This is the darker area. I'm gonna come all, this whole area here, I'll come to towards the end of the drawing, perhaps including the nose. So I'm going to look back up here now and see what we need to bring this back to where we want it. So I think in reality it's not too bad up here. So, but the hairs are quite long, and if the hairs are long, your strokes have got to be of equal nature in order to make it work. Remember the hair, if we were to concentrate on just this patch here, just like that. I'll just sharpen this up a little bit. It's gone quite blunt. I think what I'll do in a second is I'll show you the other tool I have, if I can find it, which is a Caran d'Ache pencil sharpener. Pastel scraper, I think is the correct term for it. And that's actually a really good, useful tool. I just don't like using it particularly. Yeah, a lot of these whites come down into the browns here, so I want to push those in. You can work a number of different ways with these. I like to work in both directions. I'm just adding to that layer we built up previously. And the see, as I do this, I'll bring some of this down again here. But likewise, we're going to take some browns back up here afterwards as well, because some of the hairs on the reference are really the browns coming into the whites. And there's not really, if we want to make it look right, that'll be important. Can be frustrating when you're drawing these, because it doesn't matter what you do, you can't get all the hairs in the same position. And I think some people try and concentrate on those sort of aspect, aren't those aspects, and find themselves struggling probably because of that. Okay, so we're going to add in some edge up here. If you remember from before, what I said, the hair is quite long, so we're going to need to put some of those in. We just want to remove this blue tinted edge if we can. Can't really shift it completely. In fact, there are probably ways I could have done this far better. Excuse me. And then as we come back further down, some of these hairs are going up like this. Some will go a little bit like that. That's quite a few. So you've got your hairs going in the basic direction that the hairs go in. Like this. And then the odd ones really do fly off in some strange directions. You might even have one going off cross like that. My hair really stands out then on my top end. A tough bit sometimes can be just getting these little bits of wispy bits. And this is where pit pastels don't do a great job, because they're quite hard and scratchy. But they are great for these little fine details. Is to make sure you, when you hit it, you almost press and flick it. So you've got to be really careful that A, you press and flick it in the right direction that you want to go. If you don't, it's simply not going to work. I still think, when I've drawn these here, I think there's a lot more of them. I don't press so hard on here because they stand out an awful lot. So these are very light, gentle strokes, almost letting the pen guide itself. Not that I'm using a pen. Probably do a little bit of that here as well. Well, this is the foot, so it's slightly different. Remember, this part we want almost to be greyed out, so it's not the same part of the drawing. I'm bringing the focus into the face. But if I was actually thinking about not doing these feet earlier, but when I weighed it up, I decided it was going to look like the head of a dog on a plate. I'm sure, well, there are people out there that aren't particularly dog lovers. Some of our viewers and some of my the people that do watch these videos might not appreciate a headless dog in quite the same way. There we go. That's looking quite nice, mate. So I'm gonna come back down here and start working from about here, I think. Here, as you can probably guess, the hairs are quite small. And they're going in this sort of direction. You can get a good idea from your reference picture, because where the hairs come up here, they sort of curve from the direction that the hairs are going to be drawn back from. Like this. It's tempting sometimes, and I've done it today, to do some of this a little bit too quickly. But the key is really just take your time. Mistakes are common. It's very easy to make. Not always so easy to undo. And then around the bridge of the nose here, it's really, really white. So that area there wants to be a little darker. And I remember earlier on in the tutorial, part one perhaps, I talked about having to use different colours to determine what we're going to do, or based on what we're doing up here. So we want to use some of the colours similar here to draw in some of the shadows, but we don't want an awful lot. So this is where you've got to be real, real careful, because too much of it will ruin your drawing completely, because dogs do not tend to have blue fur. So if you look, I am putting the slightest touches here. Just to pull in that bit of shadow and have it reflect a little bit of what's above the dog. Very similar to how I've drawn on the black. And that means that when we come back up shortly, the whites we draw here will show better. We hope. Plan. Constantly turning the pencil, trying to catch that bit of a fine edge. I believe I subscribe to a guy called Colin Bradley, who I know some of you will know. Fantastic teacher. And he also uses this technique. It's quite interesting when you watch what other people do, because it's very easy to think, oh, could I do this in a different way? Or should I be doing this in a different way? And you watch other people do very similar things, which is nice. It keeps us all on track, I think. Now here, look at this. I almost missed this, not sure how. There's a couple of hairs that come just up over the eye. I'm going to use the pink here because I think these hairs are more pink, certainly in this area. But there's only a few. And they just sort of go over the eye a bit like that. There we go. Some of these parts you're only going to see. So I'm hoping they will look right afterwards. And what we need to do, and this is not the easiest thing in the world to do, we have a number of little tiny hairs. So where I've gone pink, 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 you can just see the light going across the eyeball there. We've got to then do the same here. So this is a very careful drawing in of hairs across the eyeball. Just enough to be able to see them, but hopefully not enough to detract from the overall look of the drawing. There we go. Just to make these a little more artistic license says you could miss those off, but it might not look right if you do. There we go. Now here, I notice, I hope that's the right colour, let me see. Yep. We have these hairs. And I've almost covered them over, which is a shame, because this is quite a nice little patch of skin, patch of fur. Hell, you know when you're drawing sometimes and you're talking, sometimes you'll waffle that much, you're not even sure what on earth it is you're saying. I'm not sure how some of these guys do it, they've been doing it for so long. We lost that when we added the pink a little bit, didn't we? Maybe we need a very small touch of a darker brown in there. Not much. Still a little bit. Perhaps I just need to get this a bit sharper. This is where having a not the best quality reference photo in the world. Not that it's a bad quality reference photo, but it's just not very clear in certain areas. Again, this light is probably due for a sharpening. Yeah, I'm not getting this really how I want it. Oh, maybe we are. I hope this is looking on camera as good as it looks here. One of the things you often find is that your image, your drawing, your painting looks fantastic in your hand. Oh dear, it just snapped a bit off there. You can see this has left little marks on the paper there. I'm hoping they will brush off in a second, but I'm not gonna stop what I'm doing just yet. There we go. You see how where those blues and that bluey green under there? You can see it. I need to go back into here shortly and start adding some darker in there to Okay, I'm sure these whites show up and the pink we're going to add in there against it. So, let's decide where to draw next. There are a million and one bits, I think, is the real answer. But what I'll do, I think, I've lost it. There we are. As we'll start just at the edge of the ear here, adding the white in, just as we did over this area. Pencil's rather blunt now, so it definitely needs a sharpening. But if we're clever, we can get the base foundations rather than trying to add any of the fine hair detail. Might be right. If we keep turning, we find those little sharp edges. As you can see, we are. Need to zoom in and have a look at this. This is basically adding to that white undertone layer we had on there before, which really disappears towards the edge of the ear here. And all I'm doing here, not trying to be clever like before, is trying to draw some of that wispiness in that you find on the edge. And then afterwards we'll add in some more of that over there. One reason we need to do this here is because when we start putting the highlights in again on here, we want to get that finish off at the same time. Yeah, I'll just sharpen that again. Yeah, definitely something wrong with this sharpener. It just is not taking the pencils back. It's like I've got it on the wrong setting. Maybe it needs sharpening, Rob. Someone told me, I think it may have been Jason on one of his tutorials, that running a graphite pencil through your sharpener actually sharpens it. So I have some graphite pencils, nice shiny new packet, and my guess is we want a hard one pencil. I have no fingernails to get into this package with, which is great. Right, I hadn't planned on opening this and sharpening them for this purpose. But we'll see if this does anything with this sharpener and makes it any better. I can't imagine it will. But no, it's doing the same thing, it's not pulling the pencil in. No, in fairness, it's sharpened that to a very fine point, which is interesting. Let me just try again with another one. I might just break the lead off the end of this. There we are. No, not touching that end. Interesting. Okay, so it can sharpen the ends to a very, very fine point. Can it do it with these pastels? Simple answer is no. I think that's as sharp as I'm getting it, which is a bit frustrating. I've got a bit of a flat end there. And then the way to really do that then is to do it like this. That's brought me a nice little point back for drawing in some of these bits. When I get to these areas, I can be a lot more careful. Better to drag your pencil upwards or downwards. Oops. So, fortunately, where you sometimes go a little bit OTT with your lines, it's not the end of the world. I feel like I'm doing something not quite right here. Well, probably not. The highlights on this whole area are not white, so I don't want to put too many on there. And likewise over here, but I do want to have an indicator as to where I'm putting them. Well, I'm going to be putting them. And again, all the hairs coming into here. They seem to be that sort of pinky colour. There are exceptions in a few places where there's these sort of lovely bits around the eyes, which you wouldn't... White's not really the right colour. But if you put it on right, it does work. Just sort of picking up little tiny bits. Especially where you've already added the old highlight in. You're almost highlighting the highlights when you do this. But you've got to be really careful, because if you overdo the highlights, it will look silly. And we don't want it to look silly. Later on, I think adding some more white into the eye will bring that a little bit further out as well. So, let's go to here, see where we are. Quite a bit of white highlights here. If you keep turning your pencil, you sort of maintain that fairly sharp line and keep it looking like hair. If you keep it in one place, it gets flat, and you'll see a couple of times when I haven't actually rotated the pencil, get carried away when I'm talking. It just makes the image a lot flatter. The hair's a lot flatter. You end up with strokes like that one that shouldn't really be there. And while there are ways to quieten them down, the best scenario is not to do them in the first place. As you can probably imagine. So we need to add some of these pinker highlights here, I think, before we start putting too many of those in. I'll say that. They don't show up amazing, do they? And so I find myself wondering, am I using the right colour that I wanted to use? I'm fairly sure I am. where some of these hairs, they're almost like eyebrows. They start to really come across the image. It's part of me wanting to use a slightly different colour here, but I don't seem to have one that's really the one I want. I'll have a flick in a second. It might be that we have to do pretty much what I was saying before about highlighting the highlights. It does work well against some of these darker patches, especially here where we're going to come. Got this sort of kink in the eye. Want to pull them across there afterwards, don't want to go too many at one time because it won't work. So let's add in a couple of little tints and see what happens. There's a few areas where I think we need to put some nice dark brown streaks in. So we're going to need to sharpen the pencil. Unfortunately, in the local area, we don't have any art shops apart from Hobbycraft. And if you can call that an art shop, then you're probably doing better than me. And this pencil just doesn't want to play ball. So I'm going to do the old fashioned thing. I can find my little tool. Which it appears I can't. Where's it gone? Probably having drawers where everyone can access them. Okay, let me show you this. This is a Caran d'Ache pencil shaver. And the technique is basically to shave the pencil. So you just shave it down gently. I don't know if I do this the right way, but I can't see any other way of doing it. A lot of people prefer to do this either with one of these or with a Stanley or Kraft knife. I'm not overly keen on it. I struggle to get the sort of point I want. Might be easier with these because they're harder pencils, although this is actually a Caran d'Ache tool, and the Caran d'Ache pastels are very, very soft. We'll probably be using a couple of those later on. You see what I mean? I'm trying to pull that to a fine point. It doesn't sort of scrape it away in quite the same way. It gets there eventually. There we go. So I'll do the same again as I did before. I'll rub it to get that point back. Pencil's rumming around under my desk, which is not really what I want. Okay, let's see. So, I'm just going to add in some real thin lines in here. I want to try and avoid making them too grainy. And the best way to do that is to not press too hard. Some would argue just don't worry about it. And again here, well, we've got that nice orangey colour, we're losing some of the nice dark that we wanted in here. And we don't want to do that. So we're just redrawing those in. It's a constant thing when you're drawing, is to keep layering. The nice thing about pastels is you can layer light on dark, dark on light. As with graphite and colour pencils, which I've not used colour pencils, so I'm just going by what I've heard. You can't build the layers up quite so easily. Well, not in the same way anyway. Some little bits in between the streaks we've drawn in. Doesn't hurt. You just have to look closely. I turned my heating off, by the way, so I'm not sweating all over my work anymore, which is good. And then what I think about is we've got that rough thing. Just putting in a couple of nicks and do it fairly randomly. Because these are things you see when you look at the drawing, you say, oh, that's a little dark patch. Have you ever wondered how people draw or give the appearance of drawing individual hairs? They just put marks on. Everything you do in art is about mark making. I remember doing exercise in college years ago. Now, don't get me wrong, I was never a master at college. I didn't do bad. But I was no means a master painter. I think I got a distinction, which I can't really complain about. But one of the exercises there was purely about mark making. And you know, exercises are good. They teach you skills that come in well, but they're so bloody boring. Now, who wants to sit there drawing marks like this? Oh, just look what this does. Oh, look what this does. You know, ultimately, it does bugger all, apart from bore the tears off you. And I was a bit of a rebel in art school, I guess you could say, because I wouldn't sit there and do it. I had a very fixed idea of what I wanted to do with my art. I actually wanted to be a book cover illustrator. I wanted to do fantasy, sci-fi type stuff. Perhaps one of the days I'll do some tutorials on some of the more fantastical creatures you can draw and paint. I do get a bit of a kick out of it. Don't do it very often. But sometimes it's nice to draw something a little more otherworldly than a pet dog. Unfortunately, not many people have pet dragons, certainly not in England. Or if they do, they're not telling me. And then they never ask for a portrait. So we get stuck doing these and children, and I love doing things like that. Don't get me wrong, I don't charge for my art, by the way. I don't make a living out of it. I have my own business. So I don't need to. This is just, I do it for the pleasure, which is a nice position to be in. I don't envy anyone that tries to do this for a living. People are thankless. I did a drawing last year, I think it was, for somebody. And they were over the moon with it. I mean, they were literally going in raptures. And it was just a graphite drawing. And she said, well, how much do you want for it? I said, well, do you really like it? She said, yeah, I love it, I love it. I said, well, tell her. I said, just pay me what you feel it's worth. And she did. She would be £10. So you can imagine I wasn't overly chuffed. Her description of something that's priceless is a little different to mine, I guess. Never mind. And this is why I don't charge very often. I'd rather do it for the joy. That way, if somebody doesn't want to pay for something I've done, which never happened yet, but if somebody didn't like it, or didn't want to pay the asking price, perhaps that's a more accurate phrase I should be looking for, I probably wouldn't feel quite so mortified. There we go. A few little stray hairs on this side, I don't know why. But they're there. They help add to a little bit of realism. I hope it looks real. It's kind of the idea of this whole tutorial. Sometimes it's easier to stand up, as I'm doing now. Move a little bit further away. Just to see. Which bits could benefit from a little bit more work. I'm not trying to get this perfect anyway. One of the things you have to be careful of is not to have any sudden stops, because on here, especially on hair, there's very rarely a sudden stop. Or a sudden start, for that matter. There's something called the tapered pencil technique, and essentially it involves you going, so you get a taper at both ends. Quite hard to do with pastel, especially when you're trying to do detail work like this. But perhaps we'll do a tutorial on that in the not too distant future, and see if we can't help you with that side of things as well. Right, we need some more light in this area over here. Let's see. But we need to finish that there. So time for me to have a little break. Sitting on this chair does make my butt hurt. So I'm going to stop the video and I shall be back in 2 minutes. You probably won't even notice I'm gone. Okay, I'm back. Let's have a continuation of where we were. One of the nice things about moving away for a few minutes from a drawing is you can see that things that don't quite work so well. And one of the things I've noticed is that we've got this lovely bluey-green background, and while I've been drawing, I haven't been adding in the bluey-green light that would actually reflect down onto areas of the fur. And we want to bring some of that in. Excuse me. Into some of these darker areas. I'm sure there'll be people who watch the videos that will be, oh, look at that, he should have should have put those colours in there. Should have done this, should have done that. So let's just do a bit of that. That'll add a little bit of depth as well. I'm going to put heavy colours in. Just bits in places. Especially on some of the dark blacks. So you'll see what I'm doing. It's not amazingly noticeable. I'm just adding in. Some of this very similar colour to that. Into the fur. Just so we're having this bit of a continuation. And it'll just help, excuse me, it will just help bring part of this dog to life later. Here, it was too blue, daft as it may sound. So I've added a bit of brown. I'm hoping this is going to look right. It'd be a big shame if it doesn't, but if it doesn't, well, do you know what? It's just one piece of past on that. And it won't be the end of the world. I'm just literally adding that darkness into some of those shades. We've got a fair amount of it on here on this side already. There we go. A few touches. We don't want a blue dog. But we do want to show the dog in a certain light. And this can make quite a dramatic difference to a drawing. My little boy has just appeared next to me with a sandwich. Hello, yeah. Leo. You alright? Okay. So I'll stand back and have a quick look at that. Hopefully it's brought it in. And I think what I want to do, I'm going to blend that in a little bit. So go back to my colour shifter, because I don't want to.
Then what is that, Daddy?
This is a colour shaper.
This is a paper.
Yeah. Leo's very young, as you might be able to tell. Seven children, all mixed ages.
There he is.
And he's why the smallest.
That is.
It's what?
It's white.
It's great.
No.
Oh, thank you.
It's white. No.
I'm not sure if that's really what he said, but I think it is. This is just blending that blue across a little bit.
Daddy, why do you have brush, Daddy?
It's not a brush.
What?
It's not a brush. Might do we add in a couple of highlights there. I might not. As we'll see. This is really just bringing that depth to make it match in with the background, as I said before. I'll just turn it slightly and have this spread this way. Some people talk about taping their card boards. I can see the method or madness behind that. I don't do it, but perhaps I'll start. There we go. Maybe a bit in here as well. A little bit afterwards. Oh, yeah, that's quite nice. So it brings a bit of blue from the background into the drawing without being too overpowering, because we don't want to lose the colour of the dog, because that's one of the lovely things about these animals. And then we'll want to do a very similar sort of thing in the white, which of course would reflect it far more. So let me show you what I mean. Here we have some of the blue tinting. Since it's tinting where we put the white on, but perhaps we haven't got enough. What I don't want to do is make this really, really blue. But I do want to add some blue into it, because I want it to look like it's being reflected from the background. And this is a fairly close colour. So I'm literally going to try and draw in some of the slightly darker areas here. And this, like I said before, hopefully this will produce the effect I'm hoping it will. I'll blend in the image into the background a bit more. So we know from our reference photo there's a nice dark patch here. And down here. I think we haven't had enough dark in this area yet, to be honest. That dark patch is only a small area. And we need more white up here yet, so again I'm just going to put bits on so that when I start adding the white in, it will just bring it through to make it look a little bit like a reflection. We hope. And because I've done this way, I'll probably have to carry on doing it that way. So I'm going to go back to my colour shaper, make sure I cleaned off a little bit. And I'm just going to blend this a little bit. Does two things. It matches it in with the background a little better. It takes away the blue tint from the top, which was a little bit too blue for a while there. Have a little bit on the end here, just to run carefully over this area there. Right, now that looks a little bit odd, and that's okay, because now we're going to carry on as we were before with a slightly blue base. We can get away now with drawing a lot of these white lines on. This pencil's getting quite small, so I'm probably going to have to order another one very soon. Take away that. There's quite a edge in there. Not sure of the ones, if you remember before, I said we wanted to get rid of it a bit like we have over there. So let's carry that on here. Okay, so we've got these dark areas in. This has been my darkest brown I've got. So here now, I mentioned before we want to darken this area here and have it coming down like this. And likewise, these hairs really cut lightly in here. See what I'm doing now is I'm just taking any slight darker areas and I'm just trying to draw a bit of pencil in it, a bit darker. Helps it look more like the wisps that are there. It's a strange bit of hair, this one, because it sort of goes in almost in two different directions. It's not always easy to show it. hopefully we've got that sort of blue coming through quite nicely there. Standing up again. Just to try and get a view a little further away. I'd like to blend that. There we go. Remember I said about not having any hard stops. So when you see one, just try and pull the edges down a little tiny bit. The stump's coming out quite well for that. Just gotta be careful where you use them. We couldn't use that on here because it would have a real detrimental effect on your drawing, I think. I don't think I blended that blue very well down there, to be honest with you. But all right, then. You can overwork pastel quite easily. I'll just point that out because if you've got too much pastel on your paper, it comes a point where I don't know what you can do anymore. So that's gonna come up here. So we're gonna start here by just trying to draw in again the direction of the fur. So we know it's gonna come up here from the edge of this little puppy's nose. Sort of direction, and then it's going to start to curve around here. Getting any marks off this at the moment. I think I made myself a little nervous adding those blue highlights in because I don't want to ruin the picture. But I just felt it was something that needed to be done. Here we've got a fairly strong white edge of fur. So we need to make sure we put that in there. But we'll come to that as we get around further and further around the drawing. Thank you. as long as you're going in the rough direction of the fitter, some of these bits that at first glance look a bit rough actually help to show the little nuances that fur has, little tufts and areas where it's slightly uneven. When I come to do these, this area here shortly, obviously I'll need to sharpen my pencil again. Here, as long as I'm turning my pencil, I'm getting away with it. Just gradually building up the white. I may want to sharpen soon anyway. Might cause me not to add some slightly more detail here. Maybe a little dark here again. There we go. I'm not going to try and put loads in. Ideally, I should be trying to draw this as hair because I want to come to this part in a second and overlay it. So it's just a little darker than it's showing on here. We're not trying to draw, as I said quite a few times now, individual hairs. We're trying to draw the impressions of hairs. And then the odd little bits that will stand out amongst that. Oh, that will give it its shape. Sort of wispy bits. The parts of your drawings that you can't. There's no way to get around doing bits to make them work. Because if you don't, the drawing's gone, or the drawing's finished in one place and you've got to redo it. And that's a pain. We can come back and start adding these nice fine white hairs in as we did before, and we did it with the tail. Get get the basic bite in here, give it that slight impression of hair. Try to make sure you can see roughly the direction your hair should be travelling in. I don't try and draw every area in one go. I try and draw everything in one spot because that makes it not as realistic. Okay, so we want to try and draw that top hair in there. So again, we're going to need a nice sharp pencil. Which is now proving to be very, very difficult with this pencil sharpener. Who doesn't want to, do anything, in fact. Nope, it's like it's died completely. No, not really what's going on here. I'm going to have to take this apart. So I'm going to pause the video, take my whole pencil sharpener apart and see if I can fix the mounting.
See you soon.
Okay, so I've come away from this again and I've noticed there's a few bits that I'm not overly keen on. Some little hard edges, some spots that are just too jaggy. Jaggy is the word. So I'm back with another blending stump, Tortillon, and I'm just smoothing once again all these areas, just to blend that colour a little more neatly. It's a bit like shading with a pencil. I'm taking out the heavy spots of black, the bits that look a bit jaggy, and I'm just blending them in a bit smoother. There was something about it when I looked at the photograph of it while I was having a little break. Just wasn't really sitting as well with me as I'd like it to. Some people say you don't need to do this. I'm not sure I agree. I think it adds a lot of definition. It helps take away the looser pastel. And you can see where these grainy parts are. You might not be able to see it on the camera, but you'll certainly see it on an enlarged photograph. And I do like to zoom in on my art. I like to zoom in to see things that are glaringly obvious mistakes, but also areas like this where I think, oh, hang on. And this continues to add that depth as well, give that fur. It doesn't just pull the dark, it can pull the light down as well, as you can see there. And we'll do that a bit shortly when I get to that white. You can always add in some new highlights again afterwards. perhaps a little more slowly and a little more carefully. So we're doing this very much in the same way we did the hair before. Just by dragging it in the same direction, not like we were when we did the tortillon on the first or second tutorial. This is more refined. And as I say, it's a bit like shading with a pencil. So you put your shading in the directions you want the pastel to follow you in. And then we're going to go back again this way. Maybe I'll do a similar thing here shortly with the white. I quite like it here, but there's just a couple of touchy areas that I think are a little rough. These are the bits that often take copious amounts of time. I'm sure there's plenty of people out there that have ways of doing this that probably make it easier. Until I'm trying to work the colours both ways. This bit's not too bad. Quite like the way this is blended. It's slightly blurry. That's really what we wanted to achieve there. I'm gonna be careful with this. It's got a bit of a dark on the end of it. And I still have no sandpaper, as we discussed already. I think I might have been and bought some. Lazy. See where I'm taking these sharp highlights, dark lights, and just really blending them in a bit more. may not appear to make much difference to you, but to me, it does. Do not like the rough pastel look. Not used to it. So it just really helps to blend it down a bit. Right. I'm very carefully going to pull in some little bits here. Trying another one to bring the whites upwards. Just really smooths those whiskers. And those edges. Very similar to how we did on the first one. One thing you have to watch with this is where it pulls the pastel as well. It can, take it off as well as putting it, moving it around a bit. But I actually prefer using these now to the colour shifter. Had you asked me that before I started this, I might have said something different. Interestingly. Because we've carefully drawn the hairs on and we're doing this in the direction of the hairs, it does just takes away this roof. You can see here it's quite a rough surface and we don't want that particularly. It depends on what you're drawing, if what texture you want. I want the soft fur texture. I've got to draw some more white up there yet. probably drew that darker hair in there earlier on and didn't realise. Right. Okay, I think that's a lot smoother, a lot nicer to work to look at. So I'll carry on now with this white pencil. Actually, we're going to carry on with a pink pencil. Whoop. We'll start drawing in these finer hairs. Oop, he says. Maybe that needs a bit of sharpening. Just mean not to look what I'm doing before I start. This is going to be sufficient. Instinct tells us these hairs are white, and to some degree they are. Obviously, but like with many things, doesn't necessarily mean it's the right way to paint it or put it in there. Okay, that's just a bit of a foundation for the white to go onto. I'm going to turn it slightly for the way I'm going to do this. Turning the pencil all the time. Just trying to keep that slightly sharper edge on it. You can see now that I've re-blended again. I can re-add in some highlights down here. But I want to do it real careful. I'm trying to avoid those horrible little pastel grains. So a couple of these sudden marks there. the frustrating thing is that a lot of the time this doesn't show up. But when it does, it's annoying. Here with some slightly whiter hairs on. So need to make sure we include those. Can't see me on here, but I'm continually looking backwards and forwards at my reference image just to make sure that I'm getting it nearly right. I haven't taught you on down this area yet, so I can carry on as I was doing before. Adding those in. And I may do this the way I've done that there. Yeah, so let's turn this upside down so I get this nice pushing motion. I'm just going to refine my nib again. Oop. Put the paper on the floor as we go. There we go. Bit sharper. Try not to have them all the same length or the same direction. Upside down, that looks okay. Let's see how it looks. There we go. That's quite nice. I need a little bit more up here, so I'm going to put it back. The rolling pencils. To watch it sometimes. You probably hear the crunch of the very tip breaking off here. May have pressed a little hard. Never intentional. That's quite some strong light coming in this direction. So I need to get that shining through a little bit. It does get to a point with any pastel paper where it becomes a little saturated with the pastel. That's a little frustrating. Decided what to do down this area, yeah. Not sure what's going on there. You alright? Putting on a few light strands down here. I'm going to have to draw the whiskers in afterwards, but they're quite dark in this area. Some feathers going across the monitor, whiskers even. That's looking to take a bit of shape now, so I think for the time being, we'll stop the tutorial. We've got the depth of the fur in, and we're going to do the next tutorial, which will be getting that nose in. So, there we go, have a quick look at that. Seems like it's been a long day today. That's quite finickety work, but overall I'm quite pleased with the effect that's got. A couple of little bits to sort out just before I close it off. I can see that little white mug in there. We don't want that there. There we go. Wonderful. Goodbye, and I'll see you on the next tutorial.